Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, we open with a science story from Brian Lynn. Later, John Russell and Katie Weaver tell us about a new way for doctors to identify Alzheimer's disease. We close the show with the lesson of the day from Andrew Smith and Jill Robbins. But first,
astronomers say they have observed a new exoplanet that orbits far away from its star, although it is a large and massive planet. An international group of researchers said they learned new things about the planet after examining data from the James Webb Space Telescope. The telescope is operated by the American Space Agency, NASA. The gas giant, which has been named Ypsilon Indy AB, was first discovered in 2019. It is also known as a super Jupiter, meaning it is similar to Jupiter in our own solar system, but more massive. Scientists estimate the exoplanet's diameter is about the same as Jupiter's, but it is about 6 times more massive. The team said the planet has an atmosphere rich in hydrogen like Jupiter's. Ypsilon Indy AB is estimated to be about 12 light years away from Earth. A light year is the distance light travels in a year, about 9.5 trillion kilometers. International researchers led by Germany's Max Planck Institute examined new telescope images of Ypsilon Indy AB. They said they learned the massive exoplanet orbits the star Ypsilon Indy A, which is part of a three-star system. The scientists said one surprising discovery was that the exoplanet seems to take at least 100 years to orbit its star and possibly as many as 250 years. The research shows Ypsilon Indy AB orbits its star at a distance equal to 15 times the distance from the Earth to our own Sun. The researchers said they were able to directly observe the gas giant by using a tool on the James Webb to block the light of the planet's main star. The team was then able to identify the exoplanet as a bright spot of infrared light. The new findings recently appeared in a study in the publication Nature. Scientists estimate the planet and star are about 3.5 billion years old. That is 1 billion years younger than our own solar system. Elizabeth Matthews is an astrophysicist at the Max Planck Institute for Astronomy. Matthews led the research. She told the Associated Press in an email, "The exoplanet appears to be older and brighter than had been thought." The team noted the planet's star is so bright that it can be seen with the unaided eye from the southern hemisphere. But Matthews noted that nothing in the newly collected data suggests that Ypsilon Indi AB has the right conditions to support life. This is a gas giant with no hard surface or liquid water oceans, she said. Matthews said studying worlds similar to Jupiter can help scientists understand how these planets evolve over many, many years. The first exoplanets outside our solar system were confirmed in the early 1990s. NASA's total count today stands at about 5,690. The majority of these exoplanets were identified through the so-called transit method. This involves repeatedly observing drops in starlight that might happen when a planet partly blocks light from its star. Land and space-based telescopes also search for new data on exoplanets, especially ones that might be similar to Earth. NASA launched the James Webb Space Telescope in 2021. It is currently the largest and most powerful astronomical observatory ever placed in space. I'm Brian Lynn.
New blood tests could help to identify or diagnose Alzheimer's disease faster and with more accuracy, researchers reported recently. However, some of the tests for the brain-wasting disease appear to work better than others.
Doctors can confirm Alzheimer's in a patient if they find one of the disease's main signs, the development or buildup of a sticky protein called beta amyloid. Currently, doctors use brain imaging or a special test known as a spinal tap to look for beta amyloid buildup. Brain imaging is hard to get, and spinal taps are painful. Instead, many patients are diagnosed based on their behavior and cognitive exams. Now, labs have begun offering blood tests that can show some signs of Alzheimer's. Scientists are excited about the possibilities that the tests offer. But the tests are not widely used yet because there is little data to guide doctors about which kind to order and when. The U.S. Food and Drug Administration, or FDA, has not officially approved any of them, and few patients have insurance coverage for such tests. "What tests can we trust?" asked Dr. Suzanne Schindler of Washington University in St. Louis. Schindler is part of a research project examining the tests. While some tests are very accurate, Schindler said, other tests are not much better than a flip of a coin. More than 6 million people in the United States and millions more around the world have Alzheimer's, the most common form of dementia. Its usual signs, or biomarkers, are amyloid plaques and abnormal tau protein that leads to tangles that damage neurons. New drugs such as Leqembi and Kisunla can slow the disease a little. The medicines remove amyloid from the brain. But these drugs only work in the early part, or stage, of Alzheimer's progression. Few patients get the costly brain scans and invasive spinal taps that could show early-stage Alzheimer's. Even specialists struggle to tell if Alzheimer's, or something else, is to blame for a patient's problems. Schindler said she sometimes has patients who I am convinced have Alzheimer's disease, and I do testing, and it's negative. A limited number of doctors have carried out blood tests for Alzheimer's in carefully controlled research settings. However, a new study of about 1,200 patients in Sweden shows they can also work in doctors' offices. The findings suggest the blood tests may be more helpful for general care doctors. They see many more cases of people with memory problems than specialists do. However, general care doctors have fewer diagnostic tools. In the study, patients who visited either a general care doctor or a specialist for memory problems got an early diagnosis using traditional exams. They gave blood for testing and got confirmatory spinal taps or brain scans. Blood testing is far more accurate, Lund University researchers reported recently at the Alzheimer's Association International Conference in Philadelphia. They said that the primary care doctor's first diagnosis was 61% accurate, and the specialist's first diagnosis 73%. However, the blood test was 91% accurate, their study showed. The Journal of the American Medical Association published the study.
Dr. John Xiao of the National Institute on Aging said the new tests measure different biomarkers in different ways. Doctors and researchers should only use blood tests proven to have a greater than 90% accuracy rate, said Alzheimer's Association Chief Science Officer Maria Carrillo. Carrillo and Xiao agreed that the blood tests most likely to provide that accuracy measure what is called p-tau217. Schindler helped lead an unusual direct comparison of several kinds of blood tests that came to the same finding. The Foundation for the National Institutes of Health financed the work. That kind of test measures a form of tau that correlates with how much plaque buildup someone has, Schindler explained. A high level signals a strong likelihood that the person has Alzheimer's. A low level strongly suggests Alzheimer's is not the cause of a patient's thinking problems. Several companies are developing p-tau217 tests.
In the United States, only doctors can order the blood tests from labs. The Alzheimer's Association is working on policy suggestions, and several companies plan to seek FDA approval, which would clarify correct use. For now, Carrillo said doctors should use blood testing only in people with memory problems, after checking the accuracy of the kind they order. Especially for primary care physicians, it really has great potential to help them in sorting out who to give a reassuring message and who to send on to memory specialists, said Dr. Sebastian Palmquist of Lund University. Palmquist led the Swedish study with Lund's Dr. Oscar Hansen. I'm John Russell.
And I'm Katie Weaver.
Thank you.
John Russell is here now to talk a little bit more about that report. Hi, John. Welcome.
Hi, Ashley. Thanks for having me on the show.
The report we just heard describes the strengths and weaknesses of the new kind of blood tests for Alzheimer's disease. Could you talk a little more about the current tests that are used?
The main tests currently used to identify Alzheimer's disease are brain imaging and spinal taps. The brain imaging is known as a PET scan. Such tests can be quite costly. In May, Time magazine reported that the tests can easily cost $3,000.
And what about spinal taps?
Spinal taps are also known as lumbar punctures. Lumbar refers to the spine, and puncture refers to the act of poking into or breaking the surface of something. So, the test involves poking into or puncturing the spinal cord to withdraw some of the fluid contained in it.
If we had to choose two adjectives for the current tests, we might choose expensive and invasive. We could say that PET scans are expensive or cost a lot, and spinal taps or lumbar punctures are invasive, which describes medical procedures that cut the skin or enter the body.
Yes, that's right.
Well, thanks for coming on the show today, John, and thanks to you and Katie for that report.
Thanks for having me. See you next time.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In Lesson 28 of Level 2 of the series, Anna and her friend Kelly are helping with a research project about birds. They are trying to count the number of birds they see and hear in an area near their office.
Unfortunately, Anna does not find many birds. Instead, she finds something else. Listen to find out what that is.
And we're going to listen for the expressions supposed to and ought to. And we'll explain different ways native speakers use those expressions. But now, let's listen to the first part of Lesson 28.
I'm so glad we joined the Great City Bird Count, aren't you?
No. Today has been a bust, a flop, a bummer.
I'm sensing a little disappointment.
A little?
Well, my official bird watching form is almost full.
I've only seen pigeons. Lots and lots of pigeons. But I did write down some other valuable information.
Did you find a bird's nest?
No. I found 10 ice cream trucks in this 5-block area. Their music seems to follow me everywhere.
We're supposed to be counting birds, not ice cream trucks. This is important scientific work.
Well, when you want ice cream, my data will be pretty important.
Anna only saw one kind of bird, a pigeon, and the music from the trucks selling ice cream got Anna's attention more than the sound of birds did. That's why she says,
"No, today has been a bust, a flop, a bummer."
A bust, a flop, and a bummer are all informal ways of saying that something you were trying or hoping to do did not work and was really very disappointing.
Anna was disappointed, but there is a good reason she could not count the birds. Her office in Washington, D.C., which, to tell a secret, is the same as our offices here at VOA Learning English, is in an area with many tourists.
And tourists get hungry. So there are a lot of food trucks in the area, and they play music all day long.
And they play the same song all day long, over and over. I used to get so sick of Turkey in the Straw.
Yes, they do play the same song over and over. Anna hears this music and sees that many of the trucks are selling ice cream. It's hard for her to focus on birds instead of ice cream.
But she's supposed to focus on birds.
We're supposed to be counting birds, not ice cream trucks. This is important scientific work.
The modal verb, supposed to, can be used in two ways. In this example, Kelly is saying that the expected behavior is for Anna to find birds. So we can use supposed to when we want to talk about behavior we expect other people to do.
For example, for rules that we generally expect people to follow, we can say something like, "You're supposed to come to class on time."
Native speakers also use supposed to as a way of saying what is predicted or expected to happen in the future.
For example, we might say, "It's supposed to rain tomorrow." That means it is likely to rain. And when you hear someone talking quickly or a child speaking, you might hear supposed to, as in you're supposed to eat all your vegetables.
That's right. That's another example of how our pronunciation changes when we're speaking quickly. Now, let's listen to the next part of Lesson 28. Keep in mind that Anna is also very interested in spies. Spies are people who try to steal secret information from other countries or from other organizations. And listen for when Anna uses the modal verb, ought to.
No birds. Oh wait, there's another ice cream truck. Anna, focus on birds. Oh, but that truck has my favorite flavor, banana. That man is in the way. I can't see the price. I wonder what flavor he's getting. Strawberry. He doesn't seem like a strawberry kind of guy. In fact, he doesn't seem like an ice cream truck kind of guy. That suit looks expensive. Maybe he's a spy. You know what that means. The ice cream truck driver is a spy too. Genius. It's a perfect disguise. What? The man in the suit left his briefcase at the ice cream truck. I was right. He is a spy. And he just dropped off top secret information. I ought to do something. Something needs to be done. I need to do something. I did it! I took the spy's briefcase. What's that? The ice cream truck. It's following me. It wants the case back. I have to hide. This is my life now. Running. scared. Alone. That awful music! It's following me everywhere!
Hey, you found my briefcase.
You caught me!
What?
I mean, I caught you!
Well, I just want my briefcase. All my poems are in there.
Poems? You're a poet?
Well, I'm a lawyer, but I write poems too.
So you're not a spy?
You look disappointed.
No, that's okay. It's not your fault. Poems are nice too, I guess.
Once again, Anna's imagination makes her do something unusual. In this case, she steals a man's briefcase. He uses it to carry his papers.
Anna's lucky she did not get in trouble. And Anna really ought to think more carefully before she acts.
Yes, and I think that's good advice for most of us. Now, let's hear that part again where Anna uses the modal ought to.
I was right. He is a spy, and he just dropped off top secret information. I ought to do something. Something needs to be done. I need to do something.
The modal ought to can be used in more than one way. As Anna uses it here, she is making a strong suggestion. In this case, it is a suggestion to take action to stop someone from spying.
But native speakers also use ought to as a way to make suggestions that are not so strong. They often use it to just give advice in an informal way.
For example, if I see a really good movie, I can suggest that Jill see it. So I can simply say, "Hey Jill, you ought to see this movie."
Did you notice Andrew said oughta because he was speaking quickly? So you can use it to make a strong suggestion and express disapproval at the same time. For example, if students misbehave and don't listen to their teacher, the teacher might say to them, "You ought to start listening, otherwise you're going to fail this class."
In this case, the teacher uses ought to as a way of scolding the students. To scold is to strongly tell someone that their behavior is bad.
At the end of lesson 28, Anna guesses that the man's favorite flavor of ice cream is strawberry. And then she makes a little joke, using an expression about birds.
What's your favorite flavor?
Banana.
Well, my favorite flavor is...
strawberry.
How'd you know that?
A little bird told me.
When we say, "a little bird told me," that is an expression that means we have a special or secret way of knowing something about someone.
And in this case, Anna's joke has sort of a double meaning, because Anna was spying on the man when he bought the ice cream, but at the same time, she could not find any birds for the research project.
There is always a lot of humor and funny situations in the Let's Learn English series. And remember that each lesson comes with a lesson plan you can download for free from our website.
Andrew, you know, this episode reminds me, we made friends with one of the ice cream truck drivers. And he was so nice. Anyway, a little bird is telling me we ought to finish this lesson of the day. What do you say?
I say okay. And listeners, remember that you can also find us on YouTube, Facebook, and Instagram. Thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.